Nina, we have brought down the plants and pass in front.
I stopped myself. It was really good. Really good. Thank you. So, Mark, I think correctly said that the Bible is God's love letter to us. Sometimes it's tough love, and we're going to talk about that tonight. One of the areas of tough love that Jesus covered frequently in the Gospels was the area of hypocrisy. And that's what I want to do this study on tonight. I think hypocrisy is a problem we all struggle with. And even though we may not think so, the definition of hypocrisy, it's a great definition. The practice of claiming to have moral standards to which one's own behavior does not conform. The practice of claiming to have moral standards to which one's own behavior does not conform. So stated simply, it's basically wearing a mask, acting out in a way that doesn't really reflect your true self. There are a number of synonyms for it: false virtue, insincerity, pretense, duplicity. They all sound like very harsh terms, very harsh terms. So as I said a moment ago, when we practice hypocrisy, we really are wearing a mask because we don't want people to see who we really are. So hypocrisy is really the opposite of authenticity. And we actually met three masked men last week in our Bible study. When we studied the chapter 9 in the Gospel of Luke, we met three guys who pretended to be something they weren't, but when Jesus put his finger on their heart, their true nature was revealed. You'll remember, one of them, they all wanted to follow Jesus, but when he called the question on them, one didn't want to give up his comfort, even though, as Jesus said in that passage, the foxes have holes, the birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. So the first guy said he wanted to follow him, but he wanted comfort and he wasn't willing to give it up. The second guy wanted to follow him, but he wanted to get his inheritance first. The third guy wanted to follow Jesus, but he didn't want to give up his social life. So each of these men in their own way were wearing the mask of hypocrisy. Now, I think we tend to see hypocrisy in an extremely negative light. And I'm going to go through a passage in a minute from one of the Gospels where Jesus really gets down on the Pharisees for being hypocrites. So I think it's easy for us to take hypocrisy to the level of saying it's the worst of all sins. And heaven forbid that I be a hypocrite, because that's somehow worse than other things I might do. But I don't really want to be overly critical about it. I just want to be realistic about it tonight. And as Mark said, that the Bible is God's love letter to us. When God deals with our hypocrisy, he deals with it in love, because he knows that we're imperfect. So here we go. We all tend toward hypocrisy in our relationship with God, for sure. You know, there's some very apparent examples. I go to church every Sunday, but how do I do from Monday through Saturday? Sometimes the life we live Monday through Saturday doesn't quite match up with the life we live on Sunday, but I use my Sunday life to describe myself. It's a form of hypocrisy. What about reading the Word? I read the Bible every day, but how am I treating people? How am I treating my own family? Sometimes not so good. So we hide behind the fact that, by God, I'm in the Word every day. For me, it's a partial thing. I read the Word every day, and it usually lasts till about 10 in the morning, and then I hit the wall. And so it's something that we shouldn't overstate. Now, we can easily see in the Gospels, as I said, what Jesus thought of hypocrisy. And I'm going to go quickly to Matthew chapter 23, verse 23 through 28, just kind of give you a flavor. He's talking to the scribes and the Pharisees. He says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you tithe mint and dill and cumin and have neglected the weightier provisions of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. But these are the things you should have done without neglecting the others. You blind guides who strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you clean the outside of the cup and of the dish, but inside they're full of robbery and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and of the dish so that the outside may be clean also. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you're like whitewashed tombs, which on the outside appear beautiful, but inside they're full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness. So you too outwardly appear righteous to men, but inwardly you're full of hypocrisy and lawlessness." That's pretty harsh medicine. And it's hard, I'm going to tell you that Jesus did this in love. He rebuked them in love. It's kind of hard to get though, because from the plain words, it sounds like he's whacking them pretty hard. The fact is, Jesus didn't think much of hypocrisy, just like he doesn't think much of most of our sin, but he's a merciful God. And he happened to be in an environment where there was an established religious establishment in Judea, and it was run by high priests and the various sects, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and they were all hypocrites. And so he had the occasion to rebuke hypocrisy perhaps more than other sin, and he did it. So he didn't think much of it. But what he hated about it, it's hard sometimes to get past the rebuke because it's so harsh. But what he didn't like about it, and what is the problem with hypocrisy, as I said a moment ago, it's the utmost inauthenticity. Jesus wants us to be authentic. God wants us to be authentic, real people. And when we're into hypocrisy, we're not being authentic. We're wearing that mask. We're being a deceiver. So it's inauthentic, and in religious matters or matters of the spirit, it's deceitful because we're not revealing our true spiritual nature. We're wearing the mask. Look at me. I go to church every Sunday. I read the Bible every day. I do this. I do that. I help little old ladies across the street. But I'm not revealing my true self because maybe I cheat on my taxes. Maybe I lie to people. Maybe I do a lot of bad things, but I wear the mask. So that's what Jesus didn't like about it. And like so many other sins where we miss the mark, his negative feelings about it are in great measure due to the fact that it's harmful to us and it's harmful to everyone we come in contact with. And he wants a better life for us than that. So tonight we're going to try to unmask hypocrisy. We're going to get the elephant in the room out in the open and examine it. You know, in doing this study, I quickly came to the conclusion that I have many, many cases of hypocrisy in my own life. And I think we all do. Thank God we have a merciful God and we have 1,000 second chances. And I think it's good to be realistic about it and to see it for what it is, because then maybe we can try to manage it better. So the text tonight is going to be the text in Matthew chapter 19, 16 through 22. And this story is reported not only in the Gospel of Matthew, but in the Gospel of Luke and in the Gospel of Mark. And it's commonly known as the story of the rich young ruler. And you might say, as we go through this, you'll see it, you might say that this rich young ruler had it all. Like many people we come in contact with, he was rich, so he had money. We all like money. He was young, so he had time. He had a lot of time to live. And he was a ruler, so he had power. He had money, he had time, and he had power. Sounds pretty good. We probably know people like that. We probably aspire in many cases to be like that. But as you see, even though the rich young ruler had money, time, and power, he lacked one important thing, And of course, Jesus was right there to put his finger on it. That's what we're going to do tonight. So I'll read it, and then we're going to do it verse by verse. Chapter 19,
Matthew,
starting with 16 of the Gospel of Matthew. I'm sorry. Maybe I won't tell you what gospel it is. Chapter 19. Find it. Okay, here we go. Starting in verse 16. And someone came to him and said, "Teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may obtain eternal life?" And he, that being Jesus, said to him, "Why are you asking me about what is good? There is only one who is good. But if you wish to enter into life, keep the commandments." Then he said to himself, "Which ones?" And Jesus said, "You shall not commit murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." The young man said to him, "All these things I have kept. What am I still lacking?" Jesus said to him, "If you wish to be complete, go and sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." But when the young man heard this statement, he went away grieving, for he was one who owned much property. The rich young ruler who was lacking one thing. Let's go through it in a little more detail. You know, you're right, David.
I just cranked this on over here.
Yeah.
I think you might
bring
be
out
better.
The spotlights.
I think you might be better right here.
In a minute, I'm going to be like this.
Why don't you bring it over here?
Okay. Over there?
Yeah.
I
think you might be all right here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm looking at Nancy, he's nodding his head, everything I say. I don't know if he's nodding it because he's a hypocrite or I'm a hypocrite. But one of the two.
Steve.
He knows I'm a hypocrite, maybe. So let's go into verse 16. We'll just do this a little more carefully now. And someone came to him and said, "Teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may obtain eternal life?" So he's looking for the one good thing that he must do to obtain eternal life. That's a fair question. We probably all ask that, at least of ourselves. What one thing must I do to achieve eternal life? However, I think he gets off on the wrong foot. He mistakenly sees salvation as a transaction with God. What's the one good thing that I must do in order to gain eternal life? That kind of sounds like, in another sense, if I do this, then God will do that. If I do this good thing, then I'll be saved. It's a mistake we all make, frankly. The fact is, there's nothing we can do to be saved. It's not within our capability because it's already been done for us. John 3:16, famous verse. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life." So, it's not something we can do, it's only something God can do. In Acts 16:30 and 31, it's a famous story of Paul and Silas on one of the missionary journeys being jailed in Philippi for preaching the gospel. And during the night, there's some strange goings on. The jail cell is open, and the jailer is freaked out by it. So there's this interesting exchange. The jailer comes in and says, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" So the jailer says, "What must I do to be saved? What good thing must I do to be saved?" Their answer, Paul and Silas, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved." So you don't really have to do anything. You really can't do anything to be saved. You just have to believe. God's already done the work. Jesus, he's done the work on the cross. So I think he also had a mistake or had a wrong idea about the identity of Jesus. You notice in verse 16, he refers to him as teacher. In the Gospel of Mark, the parallel passage, he refers to him as good teacher. So he acknowledged Jesus as a great man, but he kind of went right past the fact that he was the long-awaited Messiah, the Son of God. He was limited in his belief to the fact that he was talking to a great man here. He wasn't talking to God. And unfortunately, belief that Jesus is anything less than God isn't going to work. It's not going to lead to salvation for us. Remember Acts 16:31, believe in the Lord Jesus and you shall be saved. So he was not just a good teacher, or as in the Gospel of Matthew, teacher, rabbi. He was Lord.
Can I interject something?
Yeah.
The word salvation in the original text, like in the Hebrew, Greek, or Arabic, whatever, the original, not the translation, Bible scholars are not totally 100% how the usage of that word is used. Salvation can actually be the name of Jesus with a capital S, calling him salvation, that we can know. And so we have to like leave it like open to be able to decide what that could be, because we're going to lose it in the translation. Because we really don't know.
So what's the verse in the Bible? I can't even think of where it is. There's no name under heaven by which men must be saved except Jesus. So your idea that salvation may be his name.
Well, if that says saved, I mean, his name's not saved, his name is salvation. But sometimes his name is used as salvation.
Yeah.
In some text, that's actually who he's called. He's called salvation.
Salvation. Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. So verse 17. So the rich young ruler says, what one good thing must I do to obtain eternal life? And he said to him, why are you asking me about what is good? There's only one who is good, but if you wish to enter into life, keep the commandments. So his answer is kind of intriguing to me. He asks him, what good thing, one good thing he can do to be saved. And Jesus responds by saying, there's only one that's good. Now Mark, the way Mark reports this, in the first verse, he actually, in the verse where Jesus responds to his statement, he actually reports Jesus as saying, no one is good except God. Because in Mark, the rich young ruler referred to Jesus as a good teacher. So Jesus is basically saying, don't ask me if there's a good thing you can do to be saved. There's no good thing you can do, because only God is good. Now it's interesting, because Jesus is God and Jesus is telling him this. It's almost like he's brushing him off and not going to the heart of the fact that, hey guy, you're talking to God. But he goes on to say, if you want to obtain life, keep the commandments. So that's intriguing to me, because I'm thinking, I thought you just said that there's no good thing that the rich young ruler could do to enter into eternal life, and now you're telling him to keep the commandments. So why is he telling him he can obtain eternal life by keeping the commandments? Isn't it just another form of obtaining righteousness through works, keeping the commandments? And I think the answer is it's actually not. I'd be interested in other thoughts about this. This is actually, I think, a Bible study unto itself. But to me, the Ten Commandments, the law which Jesus is referring to, are not just rules. To me, they're really standards for obtaining salvation and for living out our salvation. You know, in very broad terms, the first four commandments are standards for our relationship with God. And the next six, 5-10, are standards for our relationship with man that results from our salvation. So in a sense, I believe what the Ten Commandments are standards by which we live our life and enter into salvation and then play out our salvation after we've obtained it. And really, when you think about the first four commandments, you know, the first commandment, you shall have no other God before you.
besides saying you love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and there is no other God before you. The second commandment, shall not have idols. And if you truly live out those standards, you will come into a saving relationship with God. So they aren't really like rules in my mind. If there are other thoughts, I'd be interested in hearing them. But I don't think when Jesus said to him, if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments, in the sense that he was telling him to go keep rules. I think what he was saying was to change your life, to give your life to God, and then when you achieve that salvation, to allow God to play it out in harmony with what the Ten Commandments say. So now we go to verses 18 and 19. He says to him, which ones? So Jesus says, keep the commandments. He says, which ones? And he basically names off 5 through 10. Doesn't name off 1 through 4. I think he focuses on 5 through 10, which all relate to your relationship with mankind. I think he focuses on those because by the earlier interaction, the rich young ruler had already failed to pass the first and fourth commandments. And then secondly, didn't recognize him as God. So there was really no point in him focusing him on commandments 1 through 4. Jesus knew his heart and knew that to try to focus him on the first four commandments was in effect a waste of time given the condition of his heart at the time. So now we go on to verse 20. I call this verse, your hypocrisy is showing. So the rich young ruler responds by saying, all these things I have kept, but what am I still lacking? So he said, I've kept all these commandments. I've kept 6 through 10. What am I lacking? He said, I got this. But he didn't have it. He didn't have it. He was deceiving himself and presenting himself as a hypocrite because none of us got this. We all fail in this respect. So verse 21, Jesus gives him the formula for eternal life. Jesus said to him, if you wish to be complete, go and sell your possessions, give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. So what he's doing, first of all, he doesn't even acknowledge the rich young ruler's hypocrisy. He just goes right by that and just kind of gives him the meat. Gives him the meat. Now, Mark, in chapter 10 of verse 21, said before Jesus said this, Jesus felt a love for him. So when he said this, Matthew doesn't focus on that part, but when he said this to the rich young ruler, he said it in love. It wasn't like he was whacking him out. He looked at him and he felt a love for him. And then he said, if you want to be complete, give your possessions to the poor, you'll have treasure in heaven, come follow me. Went right to the heart of the matter. So, this is the matter. If you want to be complete, now it's interesting, the rich young ruler asked him what he must do to obtain eternal life. So in the rich young ruler's mind, he was like in the home stretch, because he'd kept 6 through 10, he'd lived this perfect life. After all, he was rich, he was young, he was powerful. He was in the home stretch in his mind. But what Jesus answered was a different question. He said, if you want to be complete, and what complete is pleasing to God. So I think, in effect, what Jesus was saying is, you're not in the home stretch. You're still in the starting blocks. So you can't even be thinking about eternal life. You need to think about being pleasing to God. Jesus knew he was still in the starting blocks. So, sell your possessions and give it to the poor. Jesus knew this man's idol. He knew his heart. He knew what his secret was, his hang-up was. The thing that would prevent him from coming into the kingdom, and that was his wealth. Then he goes on to say those familiar words, follow me. And as we learned last week, follow me is based on a Greek word, koletheo. It's an ongoing command. Implies a future, implies continuity, something beyond the moment, and it really means something like keep on following me. So what Jesus is saying is get that idol out of your life. Give away your possessions to the poor and come follow me. And keep following me. And keep following me. And in following me, you will be saved. So this is, after this profound statement, which goes completely over his head, this is what verse 21 says. This is the response. Verse 22. But when the young man heard this statement, he went away grieving, for he was one who owned much property. So he wanted to know what he could do to obtain eternal life, but he wasn't willing to give up the one thing that was going to prevent him from obtaining eternal life. And it's not that money or property are bad, but when they occupy a place in your life of more importance with God, they're dangerous. They're dangerous, and they will keep you out of the kingdom. So this is just how Jesus is, as we frequently see. He doesn't really mess around. Eventually, he gets right to the heart. Despite the banter that was going on between him and the rich young ruler, when it came down to it, he zeroed right in on the problem. And he really connects with each one of us in that way. We all, if we go home and close the door and take our mask off when no one's around, and really look at our own hearts, we all know that God convicts us of our idol. It may be money, it may be something else, but we all have idols. And those idols are what keep us away from God. So our choices are really, we should respond with authenticity to this probing, this poking that Jesus does at our heart. Or we just continue to wear our mask. Yeah, I feel a poking. But I'm keeping my mask on because I go to church every Sunday, I read the Bible, I'm a good person. It's really our choice. And the rich young ruler made the choice to walk away, to keep his mask on. It's an important question. And the important question that I ask myself frequently is, what one thing in my life is keeping me away from God? What one thing, or maybe what several things, are creating a wedge between me and God? What things are capturing my attention more than God is capturing my attention? So I look at this just few short verses and I say, what does this really mean to me? How do I really process this so that it's useful to me? Because in many respects, we're all like the rich young ruler. Just that we have different idols, we have different issues. You know, we all, frequently all of us want to be the rich young ruler. We want to be rich. We want to be young, or at least look like we're young. And we all want to have power. I mean, it's kind of a normal human tendency. So, in a sense, we're all the rich young ruler. Potentially, just like him. But when we also try to follow God, when the rich young ruler also tries to follow God, these things, power, money, youth, whatever it is, they get in the way. It's because we can't serve God and serve these things at the same time. If we keep them in the right perspective, and God remains first in our lives, it's a different story. But we can't serve them and God. They're mutually exclusive. So I want to say again, the rich young ruler was focused on his riches. And when Jesus spoke to his heart, he knew what his issue was and said, you need to give that idol away. He freaked and he kept on going down the road. But it may not be that, as I said, for us, each one of us. It may be something else. But if it's keeping us away from God, it's an idol. And it's just as deadly as the idol that the rich young ruler worshiped. Now, Jesus sums the problem up in the verses immediately following our passage that we read tonight. And there's two verses in chapter 19, 23 and 24, that really say it all. And this is what it is. 23, and Jesus said to his disciples, so this is after the rich young ruler went away grieving, truly I say to you, it's hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And I think there's a tendency to take that statement literally,
and say, well, if you're rich, you're going to go to hell. But I think the point is, the point Jesus is making is, you can't serve your riches and serve God. If riches become your servant and you serve God, you're God's servant, they're your servant, different story, different story. So, how do we avoid the pitfalls of hypocrisy? It's a tough order, tall order. I think there are three things in this Bible study that were significant to me in regard to that question. One is that we have to truly understand that we don't earn our salvation by trying to be perfect, by trying to be all things to all people, by wearing that mask faithfully every day. We don't earn our salvation that way. We could wear that mask our whole life and never be saved. Paul in Ephesians 2:8-9 clearly says that he says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And that not yourself, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. In Romans 10:9 he says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The first problem that I think the rich young ruler had was that he was trying to earn his salvation. He was so focused on what I call works righteousness that he was trying to scramble his way to heaven. And it's self-defeating. You can't do it. So you have to recognize that we can't earn our salvation. We can only believe in the Lord, surrender to the Lord, give our life to the Lord, and that's the means by which we're saved. I think the second mistake he made is that he completely went past the fact that the guy that was standing there face to face with him was the long-awaited Messiah, the one that was going to save him from his sins. So we have to recognize that Jesus is the key to our salvation. In John 14:6, Jesus said, I'm the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. So the rich young ruler completely missed who Jesus was. He wasn't a good teacher. He wasn't a teacher. He was God. He was God. And then thirdly, we have to know ourselves and our weaknesses. We have to all take the mask off. We have to face our hypocrisy. We can't be in denial about it. The rich young ruler was definitely in denial about it. And in effect, I think facing our own hypocrisy also lets us off the hook. I think it's comforting in a sense to come face to face with it and saying, I'm a hypocrite in this respect, and this respect. I think it's almost comforting because what you're doing, you're throwing off that false self and you're being authentic. You know, in the book of Hebrews, the author of chapter 4:15 says, for we do not have a high priest, referring to Jesus, who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. So he sympathizes with our weaknesses, but who was in all points tempted, yet without sin. So he was God, he didn't sin, but he was also man, and he was tempted. So he sympathizes with our weaknesses, including our weakness of hypocrisy. Unfortunately, the rich young ruler was in like full denial about this weakness. He was so focused on, yeah, I kept those six commandments. I've kept them from my youth. He was so focused on the externals that he was in complete denial about what was really keeping him out of the kingdom of God. So we're not told what happened to the rich young ruler, but one thing I think we can be sure of is that he had another chance and another chance and another chance. We're not told if he ever took Jesus up on one of those chances, but he certainly had the chances. And we're in a much better position because we know that we serve a merciful God and that we have 1,000 second chances. And I guess my conclusion from this Bible study is that every time I practice hypocrisy, after I do it, I need to repent of it, but I also need to recognize that I've got a second chance to do better, and that we should all take that second opportunity.
do is be married or be in a very significant relationship with somebody that's long term, that knows your authentic self. And, you know, they say, you know, it's like you're not going to get away with anything with that person. They know your crap, so to speak. And so don't be trying to pull that over on me. You might get over that at work or somebody just knows you or whatever. So it strikes me that the five that he talks about are all about community. Right? You have to be in relationship with other people because that's what's going on. You can't really be authentic without a relationship with other people, which is what we desperately need.
So it's like he threw it out there and said, if you want to be pleasing to God, keep these commandments.
Yeah.
It was like he threw the bait out.
Yeah.
Knowing what the rich young ruler was going to say, oh, I've kept all of those since my youth. So there's the hypocrisy. It was like he was baiting him to confirm his hypocrisy.
Well, to point it out, because he shows up alone, and he leaves alone, right?
Yeah.
In the story. But but he's still, if you're going to engage with people, you cannot be hypocritical.
Yeah.
You can if you just are short term. Oh, I see you at work, whatever, I go do my own thing. You're going to have a significant relationship. Somebody who knows you, they're like, don't give me that, I know you.
Yeah.
That was my thought.
That's a good answer. Yeah, this is when you think about it, this is a really curious passage because in one sense, it seems like Jesus is kind of playing with you. Not playing with him, but I think he's doing it in love, and he's trying to draw him out to reveal to him what his sin is. And the guy never really got it, so then he gets more direct. Give your possessions away. Come follow me. And the guy couldn't handle it.
Questions are really tough on us. When somebody asks you a direct question, it really draws out who you are. Somebody walks up to you and says, well, why did you do this? But you have to, right on the spot, you can't be as easily deceptive. You know, some people can, but it draws it right out. I think that's why Jesus asks so many questions, because it really puts us on the spot to draw out what's inside.
The question is oftentimes the most important thing, more important than the answer. You know, let's step into the rich young ruler's shoes for just a moment. And picture us there with Jesus, and he says, Mark, give away all your possessions to the poor and come follow me. And he's thinking, wait, didn't this guy say that the foxes have holes, the birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head? And he wants me to give away my riches and come follow him? That's a tough question. I mean, if you said yes, you probably wouldn't mean it. You probably have some buyer's seller's remorse, whatever it is. How many times have we done that? Oh, Jesus, you get me through this. I promise I'll do whatever it is. And then 2 days later, you're back to your old tricks. So it's a tough deal. It's a tough deal. Jeff?
Oh, I was just going to say, I don't understand
to me it was curious that when Jesus said keep the commandments, the rich young ruler says, well, which ones? Then he only names 5 through 10, which are 5 through 10 all deal with our relationship with other humans. 1 through 4 deal with our relationship to God. And in fact, when Jesus in the Gospels at one point says the two greatest commandments are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. What he's really doing is summarizing the Ten Commandments. First 4, love God. Second 6, love your neighbor. And he goes on to say that on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So he's saying that these two things are the most important. If you get nothing else out of the Bible but those two things, you've done well. So I think it was curious to me that he threw out 5 through 10, which were solely related to this man's relationship to other people. And I thought David's answer was great. That's what
it took me somewhere else. Yours did.
It's hard to live it out with other people.
Yeah.
The real truth comes out here, you're living it out.
Very true. Very true. To be authentic with other people, that is hard.
We have a big problem in our culture today, because it's like we get into a group and we like them for a while, and then we're like, I don't know, we move on to another group. We don't have it in churches or in whatever, or workplaces. We don't have these long-term relationships that really hold us accountable to, am I really loving? Am I just moving on?
You know, I have two women that work for me. One's worked for me for 30 years, and the other one for about 24. She's a short-timer. And I live that every day, and then I go home and I live it with Liz, because these two women know all my faults, and they know my BS. They know my hypocrisy. They're both Christians, too, so it's doubly bad. I feel like I'm walking on eggshells. And then I go home to Liz.
It keeps you alive, baby. Here you are. You didn't go to something else.
Yeah, that's true. Michael, you have...
I know someone who's very rich. He's an atheist, but he was raised Catholic, so he knows the Ten Commandments. And in one of our many discussions about Christianity, he says, why would I go to hell? I don't sin. So, like the rich man, he thinks he's perfect because he's obeying the Ten Commandments, but there's so much more than that. And so I remember I mentioned this passage to him, part about selling all his riches and following Jesus. And he said, well, that's crazy.
Yeah, it is crazy.
No, yeah, those are fighting words. Those are fighting words. You know, I heard a story about Charles Spurgeon, who's a great, great preacher of the distant past. And the story was, he was sitting in his office one day and one of his parishioners came to him and said, Pastor, I have gone the last 10 days without sin. And so Spurgeon, who was a big guy, didn't say a word. He just got up, he walked around his desk, and he stomped on the guy's foot. And the story says, and the guy let out an oath, which meant he swore. And Spurgeon looked at him and said, well, I took care of that, didn't it? Nobody lives a life without sin.
Speak up.
You got something good to say, Ray Ray. Make sure everybody hears it.
I mean, I believe in God. I lean into myself, like, but my relationship with God, I tend to sway in certain areas, and I believe that he would have been the same with the young ruler, that he had a belief in God, but his relationship with God was at a point that someone else's could be, and he was like, okay, well, you need to focus on 5% right now, you know? And understand that those commandments are actually commandments that God puts forth out of love. Remember, I used to tell everybody I had a problem with the word command. I command you to do this, that, and the other. And I used to rebel because the way that you worded it to me, I command you to do this. Until I come to the understanding that these commandments are really done out of love. And, you know, God loved them. So I guess he was telling them, look, you need to polish off on 5 through 10 real quick, you know, because it seemed like 1 through 4, you okay with it, but 5 through 10, you really need some help there. If you feel as though, you know, you have a belief in me, then you'll believe me when I tell you you'll be rich if you do away with this right here. And richness doesn't necessarily mean the materialistic richness. It's the richness of the inside, because the whole thing is about the inside policy, the inside. I felt as though, like Pastor Dave, we just went over this today, and so I was like, wow.
I was just reinforcing what you talked about today.
You know, I thought it might have been a
supernatural.
You know, talking about the inside, like Pastor Dave was sharing with me, that, you know, that light, it shines forever. But with that darkness, it likes to get gone. Soul is like dolphin, and I believe that with these other things that we idolize or whatever, we become a dog soul, because we take our focus off of God, we start from that for any and everybody. So that was my thing, like whatever he tells them to be, trying to turn whatever the case may be, or focus on that, you know, it's because out of the love he has for him. And like you said, you know, we get that second chance, third chance. I don't know how to help now, but one chance. I struggle with the whole thing to that. You want him to polish off his inside and those treasures, you know, just prevent him.
They were prevented. Yeah, this was all done in love, and it was, and he really was trying to convict him to change his life, to get rid of the impediment to his relationship with God. We all have that, and he convicted
convicts all of us to do that. We go down fighting many times, most times. But it would be great to know what happened in the at the end of the story, though, if the rich young ruler ever saw the error of his ways. Sadiq?
There's one thing about give up your riches and follow me, or a rich man making it to heaven is a camel through the eye of a needle. Is that the idea behind that is to give up your attachment to it.
Exactly.
So that I can be in of the world and have all the riches in the world, but it doesn't matter if I lose them tomorrow. Like most wealthy people, really wealthy people, if they, and you can read the stories, they could have $1 billion and then lose everything, and you'll say, hey man, boy, you must be really struggling now. You must be really down. I said, I'll have it back in a week.
Yeah.
And the old saying goes, if you took all the money from the rich and gave it to the poor, within a year's time, they'd have it back. Because the poor doesn't know how to handle the money, and the rich know how to get it back. So it's your attachment to it. Yeah, if you're attached to anything, that's your God.
Yeah, that's and that's why this story is not just a condemnation of wealth. This story is a condemnation of anything that separates you from God. Yeah, it's really an intriguing thing. And why is money so powerful in our lives? Well, we can say, well, you need money in food, shelter, clothing. But we go beyond that. It takes on an independent significance beyond what we use it for. Like,
I think what it kind of comes down to is when we sit there and we openly and honestly examine ourselves, God, of course, is going to bring to light something that's wrong in your life because we're all sinful by nature. But then we kind of fall into this trap of cultural Christianity where we're going to change God's word and God's message to fit our lifestyle. Whatever that is, you know, whether it be money, whether it be an addiction, whether it be a relationship, whatever it is, it's too much for us to alter our life for.
Right.
You know, now if we're more like a biblical Christian, where we change our life to fit God's word, then we kind of scale back on that So, and we all do it all day long, you know.
Yeah, you know, I love the Psalm 37, delight yourself in the Lord, and He'll give you the desires of your heart. The first time I read that, I thought, well, cool, if I delight myself in the Lord, He'll give me what I want. But that's not what it means. What it means is if I truly delight myself in God, He's going to change my heart to want the things that He wants for me, not the things that I may think I want for myself. So it's this whole fascination with money and power and riches is an addiction, and it goes beyond the utility of those things. It's I read a book once called Enough, and the whole function focus of the book wasn't written by a Christian, but it was written about the problem our society has of never knowing when we have enough. No matter how much we have, we only know more or less. We never know enough. God wants us to know enough. And He wants to be that. He wants to be that. So, there we go.
There we go.
Take the mask off.
Thank you. Thank you.